Everyone on New Zealand Revival Conference, and today is a very, very special day because today I was feeling a tugging on my heart that we got to do something different and unique on this broadcast because we want to reach, continue the nation of New Zealand, and God has placed this nation in my heart to pray and prophesy and bring a leadership on so we can continue unite the leadership, because I truly believe if we want to see a great revival, we need to have our leadership and unity. We need to pray with one another, regardless of the tribe and nation, regardless of any race or language. I believe if we can come together, there's going to be great revival in the nation of New Zealand. And we have said that before, that New Zealand is a leader in revival. And today we are seeing this beautiful body of Christ on this broadcast. And we're going to do something very special today, and you will be very excited. I'm going to ask each and everyone, please make sure as you're coming on, let us know where you're watching from and share this broadcast on your Facebook timeline. And that way, tag somebody named right below this video section, so that way more and more people can watch. So I want to bring Najir Paul on so she can sing the song. Here, Najir.
Kia ora, thank you. And then I'm going to open up today with the New Zealand National Anthem. So for those of you watching, please join me from home as we sing out the National Anthem of Aotearoa New Zealand over our whenua, uniting all tribes and all nations today. E hoa atua, o ngā iwi matoura, a ta whaka rongona, me aro hanoa, ki aua ko te pai, ki a tauto a ta whai. Mana aki tia mai, au te aroa. Join me singing. God of nations, at thy feet, in the bonds of love we meet. Hear our voices, we entreat. God, defend our free land. God, Pacifics, triple star, from the shouts of strife and war, Maker praises heard afar. God, defend New Zealand, land of every creed and race, gather here before thy face, asking thee to bless this place. God, defend our free land from dissension, envy, hate, and corruption, God, our state. Make our country good and great. God, defend New Zealand.
Wow, praise the Lord. Wonderful. What a great song. God defend New Zealand, Lord. It is an honor to hear. And also I'm going to encourage continue people share this broadcast with your family, friends, as we are praying. It's a prophetic act that we are praying and asking God for a New Zealand to be revived, the nation's hearts turned back to God. So I want to start with Vicky. Vicky, would you take a moment and introduce yourself?
Hi, I'm Vicky Trustram, based in Christchurch, New Zealand. Have a ministry called Master's Key Ministries. So you can go to that, masterskey.org on the web. I've been in ministry 40 years, February this year. Started off as a pastor, then an ordained reverend at Spraydon Baptist Church, for those who know Spraydon Baptist. Then went overseas, was on staff of the School of Worship in Hawaii at the University of the Nations with YWAM. Then off to Germany, and I spent 18 years in Germany, 2 years with YWAM, and then 16 years in my own ministry over there. Came back to New Zealand in 2014 and have two part-time jobs, working as pastoral support for an early childhood home-based care service, which is a Christian service, and then as chaplain for the intellectually disabled. And around that, I juggle my ministry and look forward to what God's got in store.
Amen. Wonderful. Next is, let's bring Noah on. Would you take a moment, Noah, and introduce yourself and unmute yourself?
Hallelujah. Well, it's just so good to be on. And yes, my name is Nawa Cooper, and I too am from Christchurch in New Zealand here, and a beautiful city. And I have a ministry called Nawa Cooper Ministries. It's a prophetic ministry. I was ordained a prophet to the nation of New Zealand by Todd Weatherly and Daryl Crawford Marshall from Australia. They came over, and so it was quite a surprise, actually, and that was a number of years ago now. So I've just been growing in the ministry. I'm full-time ministry itinerant preacher, and have travelled extensively and to other nations. And God is just opening doors, and it's just an absolute pleasure that this door has opened and allowed voices to come on and share what is happening. So thank you so much.
You're welcome. Thank you so much. I'm going to bring Terry and Bruce on. Terry, let's start with you, and then Bruce will introduce himself.
Okay. Hi, everyone. Good evening. Good morning, wherever you are. Doxa to Theo, that means praise the Lord. In Greek, it's so happy to be here with Bruce and Papamoa in Tauranga in the Bay of Plenty of New Zealand. So glad to be here with you all. I'm happily married to a beautiful wife, Dalwin. She's not with me at the moment, up in Auckland. We're hoping to relocate there soon to be closer to our family. So I've been married with her for over 30 years, and we've got four adult children, three girls and a boy, and just such a blessing to us. And we've got two grandchildren. One is about to be born in October, so very blessed to have such a wonderful family. We mentioned before the year 1986. That was the year I was powerfully born again in mid-80s, and I was involved with the Baptist Church and the youth, and through the 90s in governance with the deaconship there and worship leading. And then the early 2000s was involved with CLCA, which as you'll know now is Life New Zealand, a great church. I was the children's pastor there for a little while, looking after four centres, over 700 kids. So a massive responsibility, but such a wonderful time. So I've been involved with kids ministry since I became a born-again Christian, really. And lately been involved with Community Bible Study in New Zealand. It's a worldwide organisation, Community Bible Study International. And where we get to study the Word of God, and it's just powerful. And I'm just so excited that we get to study this amazing thing called the Word of God. And it's truly powerful.
Great. Thank you.
Amen. So I'm Bruce Ray, director from Vision Television Network in New Zealand. also run Breath of Life Ministries, which is a ministry that we take to other countries and hold healing meetings, both in Auckland and here in Tauranga. And we're blessed to see God move in power in many lives, healings, deliverances. And also what I do is I encourage Christian people to move out in the gifts and ministry of the Holy Spirit.
Yes.
To move out in ministry of deliverance and healing. And that's mm-hmm. what Breath of Life Ministries is all about. It's encouraging people to start getting out there and using the gifts that God has already given us. Amen. Amen.
Amen. Yep. Amen. Wonderful. I want to bring a powerful prophetess, Najir Paul, on this broadcast. Take a moment, and we love your voice. We love the song, National Anthem of New Zealand. You such have a gift and an anointing over your life to go greater. So praise the Lord. Go ahead.
What a fantastic intro, Adnan. I don't think I need to say anything else. You did it all for me, brother.
don't do that. It's just like my tongue was untied and I'm like, there you go. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah. Look, I just want to say, kia ora, ngā mihi, kei te mihi nui ki a koutou katoa, kua tai mai I tēnei rā. Greetings in the name of our Lord and Saviour Jesus Christ to all of you who are watching now, who are going to be watching the replay. Ko Ngere Paul Aho, I am Ngere Paul, kei te noho ana au ki Kawerau I roto I Bay of Plenty. I am currently living in Kawerau in the Bay of Plenty. I am from Tauranga Moana, where Bruce and the brother there are sitting. That is actually my hometown where they are, in Tauranga Moana, and I like to get back there as often as I can. I am an itinerant minister, but when I'm not travelling around and doing different things, I have two weekly broadcasts that I run from Facebook Live and YouTube. If you want to check those out, Kapa Kōrero every Monday and also Fire Friday every Friday. And I'm much like everyone else here today. I have a heart for the fivefold ministry. I love operating in all five. I love to bring others in and through that and see them being released in their gifts. It just gives me so much joy. And just want to say thank you to the panel today for having me here. It's such a blessing. Kia ora.
Absolutely. Wonderful. And those who are wondering, I'm a founder of Vision Television Network. And Vision Television Network been around 8 years now. And I came back to Vision Television Network a year ago. And since then, it's been blowing up. Our heart is, after Cindy Jacobs prophesied, that Adnan, your channel is a part of a billion soul harvest. And this is what exactly we're doing. My heart is to win billion soul and win all it for Christ. And it's not about me. It's all about Christ. I'm an evangelist from Houston, Texas. My heart is to see those who don't believe in Christ, those who are non-believers or belongs to a different religion, to encounter Christ in their personal life, the way I have experienced Christ in the age of 12. So Vision Television Network now is being broadcasted in over 50 nations over the continent of Asia through satellite, and then also through IPTV, through digital platform all over North America, South America, and Africa. People can watch. And these broadcasts, we are going to take and broadcast it on a actual television, which is over satellite, Vision Television Network. And we are hoping millions of people will watch and pray for the nation of New Zealand on their knee and pray for revival in this nation. I want to see a great change in New Zealand, change in a political, change in a school system, change in economy, and anything that from top to bottom. I want to see God and Holy Spirit move, as the national anthem says, God defend our land. So absolutely, we need to pray for New Zealand. We got to stand together for New Zealand. And I'm not even from there, but God has put on my heart to pray for New Zealand. And I love New Zealand, and I love the people of New Zealand. So now, next, we're going to go into our section. And I'm going to encourage everyone, if you have not shared this broadcast on your Facebook, please do. It's just a one-button click. You go and go on Vision Television Network right now. on our Facebook, and you can share it on your Facebook. That way, more and more people can join. And those who are watching right now, please feel free to let us know where you're watching from, the name of your town, city, and state. So let's bring back Vicky. Vicky, would you take a moment and share your heart for New Zealand?
Where do you start? I think the thing that I desire to see is alignment. And in fact, the prophetic word that I shared at the Prophets Roundtable earlier this year was along those lines. It was all about alignment. winds of change, open doors, alignment, abiding, and revival and awakening as the result of the alignment and the abiding. And in that, the Lord actually spoke about alignment also with Israel, that this wasn't a time to judge Israel, it was a time to stand with Israel. And I really believe if we want to see revival come to New Zealand, there has to be a unity. And that goes back to a reconciliation too with the Māori, the Indigenous people of New Zealand. I was sent a word about a year ago, and then it's popped up again. And I just want to read it because I actually know someone who was at this conference. And this is my desire. I want to see that through the reconciliation between Māori and Pākehā and the unity of the body of Christ and the humility of the leadership, that there is a coming together, that we see the release of the Spirit of God. He keeps talking to me about winds of change. But for those winds of change to stir, there has to be this unity. And the word goes like this. And a dear brother here in New Zealand, Selwyn Stevens, has put it up on his site. But it was a conference, prophetic conference in Germany in 1983. And a brother from Tanzania got up and said, in the southern oceans, there is a land named after a cloud. Aotearoa, the land of the long white cloud. That's New Zealand. In the southern of the two main islands, there is a city named after God. Nawa and I are sitting in it. It's called Christchurch. In that city, I will pour out my spirit in the great end time outpouring that has been prophesied. Smith's Wigglesworth talked about it and saying it would start here. But, says the Lord, I will not do this until the colonizers of the land have apologized to and honored the indigenous people of the land. Once this happens, I'm getting floods of God bumps, guys. Once this happens, I will raise up the leaders of the end time revival from among the indigenous people of the land. Now, the only ones who understood that word in the conference were the five New Zealanders that were there. And I really believe, and that's my passion, to see we come into this place of unity. Like the others, that the prophet in me has the passion to stir up these things. But there's another side of me, the teacher, and I believe in deep foundations and discipleship. And I have the privilege, I lead two Torah clubs here in Christchurch through First Fruits of Zion, which is looking at the scriptures through messianic Jewish understanding. And we've got to go deep in our roots in the word that we can stand firm to see the revival happen. So I'm waiting for doors to open up, to go into the nation and be involved, not just in bringing the prophetic, but actually that the word of God is the foundation. You know, we have to remember that in Hebrews 6, it talked about it's time to leave the elementary teaching. But when I read the elementary teaching, half of the things on the list aren't even preached in our churches. Let me just remind you, the elementary teachings are doctrine of baptism, laying on of hands, resurrection of the dead, and eternal judgment. I've actually missed one, and that's repentance. And that's a huge thing. And the word the Lord gave me in this prophetic round table that was shared at the Behold conference earlier this year, the key thing was repentance. And yeah, and I believe as a nation, we've got to walk into that repentance and humility, come into that place of apology and putting things right with the Indigenous people so there can be true reconciliation and understanding the biblical, the Hebrew understanding of reconciliation and forgiveness. It means a restoration. It means a coming into that newness of restoration. And that's my passion for New Zealand. And I hope I haven't gone over time.
Don't worry about it. I love it. Praise the Lord. That's exactly what we needed to hear. You nailed it. Praise the Lord. Wow. I'm just like, while you were speaking, Vicky, I could just feel the goosebumps and all the glory to God. It's powerful. I could just feel the anointing just flowing through your voice. Thank you, Jesus. And I want to bring Nawa on. Nawa, could you share your heart for New Zealand? You got a Nawa Cooper Ministries.
Yes.
What is your heart?
Well, absolutely my heart. And I'm sure it was imputed into me, even as a child, for revival, even though I really didn't understand anything about such things. But I know that I'm a revivalist and I carry revival, and I have an absolute heart and passion for this nation. And just what Vicky was saying about reconciliation. And you know what? Things are moving and changing in this nation where there is a reconciliation, you know, between the Māori and the Pākehā, and not just the Māori and the Pākehā. And obviously, you know, we're a very multicultured nation, but we're looking at the First Nations people. And I mean, Nawa, my name, Nawa Wakore, is Māori. I mean, I've got Māori ancestry, blood in me. You know, I'm not just a part Māori. I used to get quite confused as a child because I would spend a lot of time, and I was in the country, and I spent a lot of time with the neighbours who were full Māori, and it was like, and I just loved that. And so it brought about a bit of confusion for me because, I mean, being so white and that, but feeling the culture, feeling the heart of the people, and it hasn't gone away. And so therefore there is a great reconciliation that is taking place in the land, which really can only come from the Lord. And he is bringing this nation to its knees. And it's like he's establishing prayer hubs up and down this nation. And there is a great a sense of awareness that is coming upon the body of Christ. And he gave it to me a couple of days ago. He said, I'm going to release a great awareness on the people. He said, up and down this nation. It's like, I find it hard just saying this nation because I feel, you know, it's for the nations. But since we're sort of focusing on New Zealand, he said, there is going to be a great awareness that I'm going to release upon the body of Christ, which is going to bring them, because we can talk about unity, we can preach unity, but unless God comes in and touches the heart of the people, which brings them into true repentance, which brings them, and I say them, I should say us, which brings us to our knees, and that where we just absolutely abandon ourselves and where we cry out to him, and that one accord where we can put all our indifferences aside. And, Baptist, it's Pentecostal, charismatic. It's like, let's just lay all that down and let's come together in one accord and agree on one thing, that we need God in this nation and that we need God to move in this land. And he is moving. He says, you know, that he will honor the cries of our heart. He hears the cries of our heart, and he says, if we diligently seek him, he says, I will reward those who diligently seek me with all of their heart. So my heart is absolutely for revival for this land. You know, there is a shaking. We know that there is a shaking, and it's not the devil. I mean, the devil's certainly doing his bit out there, but God is really shaking the body of Christ right now. And he gave me that word probably 2 years ago. He said that he was going to shake everything that could be shaken. And we're beginning to see that. And he took me into a vision, if I can share real quick. He took me into a vision at the beginning of the year, and where Jesus walked into the church, and he had a crowbar, and he began to pop up. The floorboards were pristine. It was highly glossed. It was like everything looked in order in the house. Yet he came in and he began to pop the floorboards, and I was shocked. This was an open-eyed vision, and I was shocked, and I said, Jesus, what are you doing? You're wrecking the floor. And he just kept pulling up the floorboards one after the other. So me being nosy went over to have a look. And when I looked in, it was like, it was just so vile. And he says, I'm now going to expose what has been hidden in the body. He said, before I can come and release my glory, he says, I'm going to clean up the house. And it was like, it was shocking. And so therefore, you know, we're seeing that happening now around the globe, that he's coming in and there is great exposure that is taking place, but he's not doing it to harm the body. He's doing it to redeem the body. And so I'm going, God, come and just release, God, your presence and your power and your love and clean us up. So, yeah, I'm all for unity. I'm all for revival. And that, but I know that there is a deep cleansing that is taking place, and yet there is more yet to come, but we need to embrace it and to see, you know, what is going to come next, which will be the great outpouring of his spirit in New Zealand.
Yes. Wow. We need to embrace it. We need to embrace revival. Wow. That's so powerful. Praise the Lord. I'm going to bring Terry and Bruce on. Both of your hearts, would you share your heart for New Zealand?
Yeah, we've just had a significant event in New Zealand. The Maori king had died. And
yes,
not all the tribes of New Zealand were part of the Kingitangi movement, but a significant amount were. But what has been exciting to see is the number of tribes who have come together and been part of the mourning process for the death of the Maori king. And he was preaching a message of unity, the people coming together and working together in unity. Dame Fenna Cooper, going back many years, she was preaching unity as well. Mm-hmm. And what I'm hearing in the church leaders today is a message of unity. What I'm wondering is how we're going to get from preaching unity to enacting unity. In reality, there's a lot of division in New Zealand in many areas. There's a lot of issues between Maori and Pākehā. There's a lot of confrontation between some Maori and Pākehā. Somehow we've got to get past all the negative stuff. And as a nation, we need to come together in unity. It's been talked about for a long time. There's been a lot of words said, but yet it is yet to happen. And those prophetic words that we've heard today and on previous broadcasts are really powerful and really significant. But we need to see it happen.
Yes.
And we need to see it happen soon. And that's when we will see New Zealand dramatically changed. Mm. That prophecy that was shared earlier you know, these prophecies are powerful. But I long to see the fulfillment of these prophecies so that they're not just words, they become reality. So that New Zealand is able to see the power of God move in great anointing in this country. I believe it will happen. I believe it's going to happen. My heart is for it to happen very, very soon. Amen?
Amen.
Over to you, Terry.
Wow, how do you top that? That's awesome. We can stop right there and just say, let's just go out and live it. This is what I believe the Lord is saying to you. Are you ready? Revival. We've been waiting for revival. Many people have been waiting for revival, and they've been waiting for God. It's not up to God. God, revival does not depend upon God. Revival depends upon us. And I'll qualify that. God poured out his spirit. He said it is an axe in the end times, I'll pour out my spirit. And that was at Pentecost. They waited 10 days after the ascension of Christ for the fulfillment of the power of God. Acts 1:8 power came after 10 days. No longer do we need to wait. Our families don't need to wait. Our wives and kids don't need for us to wait. It's up to us. Who is the us? First of all, it always begins with the man. In Ephesians 5, it talks about God is over Christ in terms of headship, who's over the man, who's over the wife, who's over the child or children. That is the godly order. But I want to bring back this to how we started with our beautiful national anthem of New Zealand. Do you know there's at least, I think, 5 or 6 verses? I think we sung 3, didn't we? Can I read to you just quickly verses 4 and 5? Let our love for thee increase. May thy blessings never cease. Give us plenty, give us peace. God defend our free land. From dishonor and from shame, guard our country's spotless name. Crown her with immortal fame. God defend New Zealand. And verse 5, may our mountains ever be freedom's ramparts of the sea. Make us faithful unto thee. God defend our free land. Guide her in the nation's van, preaching love and truth to man. Working out thy glorious plan. God defend New Zealand. And what I love about those two verses is, let our love for thee increase. Make us faithful unto thee. If our families could see that the man is in love with Jesus more than anything, the wives will be astounded and amazed. And if the man would love Jesus with all his heart, his kids will see what true love is. True compassion is true dedication to Jesus first of all, and then his children will somehow just come into an alignment. There's many, many families where kids are off doing their own thing, and we're praying as if it's God's problem or as if it's God's fault. It's not. If us as men were to get back in love, we know how to love, you know. Us guys, we know how to love. We love rugby. Some of us love beer. Some of us love all the wrong things. But we need to love the Lord Jesus Christ. We need to love this. We need to love our beautiful wives. We need to love our kids, not for what they can do for us, but because who they are. Once we see that, and once revival happens in the family, everything changes. My daughter, she lived overseas for a very, very, very rich family, as in houses, jets, not just one jet, jets, many things, super, super rich. And one of the kids says to her, I never asked for any of this. They just want mum and dad to be around. That's where things happen in the family home. That's my passion. where we get back, as Vicky said, back to the Word of God, back to the Word of God, and seeing alignment. Someone mentioned alignment. We get back to this. Wow. And what happens, one of the first things of love is, I'm sorry, please forgive me. That's to the Lord, that's to the wife, that's to the kids. And you see, my children, they're grown up, they all love the Lord. They're all doing their thing for the Lord. And I'm amazed. For me, I'm a super, super rich man because I look at my kids and I think, thank you, Lord. I have such beautiful kids who confess the name of Jesus.
Yes.
That's revival.
Yes. Yes, sir. Wow. Perfect. Absolutely. Loving God from our heart and loving a family, you know, and that's true revival. Thank you, Terry, for sharing that. I appreciate it. Now we want to move into our next section, a prophetic word. You know, we spoken about it, that shakings are coming, you know, and God is going to bring a great revival. But I want to see now all comes through. We are in a, not waiting for it, but what we are seeing and experiencing, it is a revival, because you see the rise of evil, but and the rise of the goodness also. And so many people are, whether they confess that they're Christian or not, but I'm seeing more and more people are experiencing that who God is. They're turning from evil and turning towards God. Mm-hmm. And this is happening in real time. People are waking up to it. So I'm going to bring back Vicky on. Vicky, would you share any, I think you jumped ahead and you shared a phenomenal word for New Zealand, but anything specific that God is speaking to you? You brought Smith Wiggle's word, prophetic word over New Zealand. So any other prophetic word that, you know, you feel on your heart for the nation of New Zealand?
Well, actually, part of the other aspect of the word I had was the breaking down of revival and awakening. And I hear Terry on that we're involved in revival, but I actually do believe that only by the Spirit of God can there be a move in revival. It's that two-play thing. And, you know, revival means something that was dead being revived, and a lot of the church in New Zealand sadly is like that, and not even just the church. I remember I had this dream one night, and then I woke up and I was asking the Lord about what it meant, and it came down to the fact of, he said, there's too many of my people who are like the walking dead. Mm-hmm. And that kind of shocked me. Because we're the ones, like Terry said, because of the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, should be full of love, joy, peace, you know, and it says joy and peace, that's the kingdom of God. That's the signs of it. And, you know, the challenge of that is that in the revival that we're stirred to go into that deepness of abiding in him. And out of that awakening comes. Awakening is the non-Christians, those that are in the world, being absolutely awakened with veils falling from their eyes to the truth and the facts of Jesus. The Welsh revival, my heritage on my mother's side is Welsh. And, you know, the Welsh revival was radical in what happened. And we need that radicalness within our nation. And yes, there's a lot of darkness in the world, but it's the time for us to arise and shine. That word shine there in the Hebrew is to illuminate, that we should so illuminate wherever we go. And I think that's where all of us, like Terry said, have to acknowledge our own personal responsibility of what it means to be a follower of Jesus, our own personal responsibility to be a steward of, one, the gifts that he's given to us, that he's empowered us with, the talents he's given, the place of our work. So often we moan and groan where we work, rather than seeing that we can be influencers. You know, when you look at Israel and all the nations around it, even through history, even within Bible history, all of the other nations had the power and the money, you know, because they were the fertile crescent, whether it be the Babylonians, the Assyrians going down to Egypt. But what was God wanting Israel to be right from the promise he gave Abraham? He was wanting them to be influencers. And that's no different for us as followers of Jesus. We're to be influencers. And again, the word that I had, it was about, you know, we can only do that if we abide in him. And for me, abiding means like sitting on the lap of Jesus, sitting in, nestled into Yeshua, that I can hear his heartbeat, I can hear his whisper. And I walk in the spirit in doing those things he's called me to do. Not to move from that position of abiding in him. I'm to stay in that position of abiding, because in staying in that position of abiding, that's where I'm empowered. And so my passion in the words that, you know, the word I gave at the beginning, the reconciliation, the word of Smith Wiggles' word, the word that I've had, and I know Nawa's had a powerful word. Yeah, it is like Bruce cried out, I want to see it happen. And what I would say with that, I think of children, you know, when you're playing tag, you know, the Holy Spirit's tagged us and he says, you're it. And I think if there's a practical to do, it's to be praying for our leaders that the revelation comes. It's not about building our church. It's not our church anyway. Jesus said he would build the church. And in fact, all the churches in Christchurch fellowships, looking at an example. The church in Christchurch is all of those fellowships together, and not about building those in the empire. It's about building the kingdom of God. And the way we go about that is not seeing, and for leaders not seeing, the littleness of their own fellowship, but the bigness of God's kingdom, and saying, let's embrace together, repent of those things we need to repent of, and walk into those things that God wants us to do. So the key, and all of us as prophets know this, you know, if you're a prophet, a lot of your time's on your knees. And it's praying to see leaders and those ones in influence over many coming to a point of repentance where it moves the whole of the body of Christ into position and alignment with what God wants to do. And I'm praying like you, Bruce. It's like, how long, oh God?
Absolutely. Wow. That's a power pack right there. Amen. We're going to see that happen by the grace of God. Noah, any prophetic word for the nation of New Zealand?
Yeah, well, it's like since we're on the whole revival thing, I mean, the Lord had taken me into another vision, but just before that, on Sunday, he gave me a word and he said, let the people know that there is a sound of the abundance of rain and that there is going to be an opening of the ears, that they will be able to hear what is coming in the spirit, and that we are to position ourselves. And just as Vicky said, you know, that positioning, he took me to 1 Kings 18, 41, and we all know the story so well with Elijah, and the drought's been on for 3.5 years. And he sends his servant out to go and see, you know, if the rain is coming. And that he said, I hear the sound of the abundance of rain. And, you know, he positioned himself where he put his head between his knees, and that where there was just no distractions. And he was in intercession. And I know that God is calling the intercessors of this nation to position themselves and to get down and to begin to groan and pray, because he's given us a promise. He said that there is going to be this billion soul harvest. Well, it's just not, it doesn't stop at a billion souls. It's like, I mean, that's the minimum. It's like, I'm going, God, go beyond that. Go way beyond, Father, our expectations. But his expectation on us is that we position ourselves in a place of prayer, and that we begin to cry out, that we begin to have that the heart of God, and pray for souls to come in. We're praying, and it's like it's happening. He took me into a vision when I was in Israel, and it was like in the vision, my pastor came to me and said, Noah, where are the intercessors? And I said, I don't know. I said, I'll go and get them. And I feel that the Lord has commissioned me in this nation to wake up the intercessors. And it was like, and I ran downstairs. I was in this basement, and I turned the light on. The intercessors were asleep. And I began to call them and say, you need to get up. You need to wake up. And because these are urgent times. And so Elijah heard the sound of the abundance of rain. And he heard rain coming before it was even seen. And it's like, and we see revival here in the land before it's even here. And it's like, so we're not to lose heart. He says, don't quit. Don't give up. Don't grow weary and well-doing. He said, we're in due season. And I want to say this, New Zealand, that there is a due season that is coming to you now in Jesus' mighty name. And it's like there is going to be, when I said to you, Bruce, you know, is it fine there? And you said, oh, yeah, there's a wee cloud. And I just went, thank you, God, that I am hearing. It's like there it was a cloud the size of a man's fist when the servant came back to him. And it's like we can think, oh God, we've been praying, and it's like we've had these prophetic words that have been coming forth for years, and we've been longing to see the power of God move in our nation. And it's like, and people are ready to quit on the second go, the third go, the fourth go, the fifth go, the sixth go, but on the seventh go, it was like there was a cloud that came, and he said to his servant, quick, go and tell Ahab, you know, to go. He said, because the rains are coming, and there was a downpour. But not only that, I want to say that there is going to be a supernatural ability that is coming upon the body of Christ, upon the ecclesia. It's like the true believers of God, those that have not quit, those that have not given up, those that have been on their knees. And it's like crying out to God. I wept this morning for an hour. The Spirit of God came on me, and I was crying and weeping for God to come and release an awareness upon the people, to release a sound upon their ears, that they would hear the sound of rain coming. And then with that, it was like Elijah got up, he was girded, and God's hand came upon him. The hand of God is upon this nation. The hand of God is upon his ecclesia. The hand of God is upon the church. It's like, so don't be frightened. Don't be afraid. Don't grow weary. This is the word of the Lord. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. You just shook all this broadcast. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Glory to God. Lord, be ready. We're desperate for you. So let's bring on Najir Paul. Have a prophetic word. I know on her heart. Let's hear what the Spirit is saying, because she is a brave, bold, and go-getter. So here to you, my dear sister.
I am going to try not to take too much time, because I know that we're on a specific time frame here. I do have a word. And what I want to bring about is, I want to bring it back to today's a very important day. Today, the nation of New Zealand buried King Tūheitiapaki, the Māori king. He is the indigenous, I am indigenous Māori to New Zealand, and he was our indigenous king. There might be many that might be watching saying, oh, that's got nothing to do with us because I'm not a Māori. Let me tell you now, it has everything to do with you if you were a part of this nation. And I want to paint a little bit of a background picture for you, whether you're Māori or not, so that you understand. First, what happens in the spirit will then happen in the natural. And I just want to bring a few facts to us today. So he was buried today. Now, his daughter, she is his young only daughter. This is very unusual. What's happened is she has succeeded the Māori, the kingitanga throne, above her two older brothers. The woman, the daughter, the youngest. Are we getting this? She succeeded to the throne and was chosen over her brothers. They relinquished their right to the throne. They gave it to their sister. Her name is Queenie, or Queen, Ngā Wai Hono I Te Pō. Now, her name means the connection of waters, two waters, in the night. So catch that part. She is the eighth Māori monarch. She is only the second Māori queen to ever succeed the Māori throne. She is only 27 years old. And she is the second youngest Māori monarch to ever be appointed. Now, her grandmother, who was Queen Dame Te Atarangi Kahu, she held that role for 40 years. 40. So if you're into numbers, you're staying with me. I know you're tracking. 40 years, her grandmother held that throne, and now she's taken it over at the age of 27. Now, she was anointed on Thursday morning, this morning, anointed in a ceremony by the Kingitanga Council, and that's a council of 12 different, representing different tribes, Māori tribes, right? Now, that ceremony is also known as the whakawahinga. That means the raising up. The word whakawahinga, how they coronate, the coronation, it means raising up in English. So keep tracking with me here. Now, what happens is when they anoint a new Māori king or queen or a monarch, they go through a process, and a part of that process is where somebody, and the eldest member of the previous original kingmaker family, one of those senior elders will come, and this is what they do with the new king or queen, and in her case, with her. They will come with the Bible, the original Bible that was originally used back in 1858 to anoint and coronate the first Māori king. That Bible is still here. That Bible was placed on her head. And this is what they will say to her, the family of the original kingmakers. They said to her, and it said on every, they said to her, in the old days, your ancestors were anointed with oil. But since the arrival of Christianity, they have been anointed with the word of God. Therefore, we place the word of God on your upoko, on your head.
Wow.
So that's the first time that took place was 166 years ago, the first time it happened. That's the same Bible that's being used, right? Now, after the coronation, what happens is a rangatira, a chief, he comes and he presents to the queen, which is what happened, a white feather. And we know here as prophets, white feather symbolizes purity and truth. I want to bring to you guys today the verses, Psalms 147:15. He sends out his command to the earth. His word runs very swiftly. Verse 18 says, he sends his word and he melts them. He stirs up his breezes. Sister Vicky's been talking about winds of change. And then the last part of the verse says, and the waters flow. Let me remind you again that our new Māori queen, Ngā Wai Hono I Te Pō, her name means the connection of two waters in the night. Psalm 147:18 says, and the waters will flow. And this is where I want to come to, painting all of that. There has been a change of guards. At the beginning, I sung the song, God Defend New Zealand, the New Zealand National Anthem. And I sung from dissension, from envy, from hate, from corruption, guard our state. The new Māori queen has been commissioned, and she will play an integral part in the kotahitanga, or the unity of not just Māori and Pākehā, but all tribes. This is symbolic also of what is taking place in the wider body of Christ.
Wow.
Wow. Praise the Lord. What a symbolic prophetic movement is unity. And as I was saying in the earlier, that we needed unity in the leadership. And what eloquently she have described that how crucial is crowning the new queen. And she's young, 27 years old. What amazing, because that shows the new generations, you know, it shows that it's this, what a symbolic and new way of thinking and coming with the with this passion and new blood and new wineskin. Wow, I can just go on and on. That's a very powerful. Thank you, Sister Najir, for sharing that. That's a powerful. I'm going to bring Bruce, I'm going to go into prayers, if that's okay. If you could lead us both into prayer, that would be great.
Let's pray. Lord, I'm reminded of an old story when there was no rain for many, many months, and the people held a prayer meeting, but only one little boy turned up with an umbrella. Mm-hmm. And I'm reminded of the story in the Bible where Peter was imprisoned, and there was a prayer meeting being held for God to move in power and for him to be released somehow. And God moved in power, and there was a miraculous event, and got out of prison, and he was knocking on the door, and someone opened the door, immediately saw it was him and closed the door. These people had been praying for something, and when they received, they weren't ready to receive. My prayer, Lord, is that we as a nation will be ready to receive, that we will have great expectancy. We won't be the only one that turns up with an umbrella, that we will be a nation who are ready to receive what you have for our nation, Lord, that we would have the ears to hear you speak to us and the courage to keep in step with what you are doing. That when you open those doors, that we will see that it is you and invite you in and feast with you. Lord, have your way in this nation. We don't want to be a nation who talks a lot and does little. We want to be a nation who is ready for you to move. And in your timing, when you release, Lord, we want to be there and be part of it and welcome what you are doing. So, Lord, we thank you for all that you're doing. I thank you for the words that you've brought today. They are so powerful. Help us not to forget them. Help us not to leave them just slide away from us. Help us to remember and to take heart of the things that you are doing and keep in step with what you are doing in this nation. Amen.
Amen.
Terry, it's your turn.
To pray?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Heavenly Father, again, we want to say, blessed be the name of God, even the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and the God of all comfort. Again, we're so grateful for you, Lord. We come before you with gratefulness and thanksgiving. We bless you that you are a God who has changed lives. You've given us your word. And I love the way that the word of God was placed so poetically and metaphorically upon the head of the new queen, that the word of God would be in our heads and in our hearts and in our lives, that the word of God will not return void. So, Lord, I bless you. I thank you for your word. I thank you for our brothers and sisters and the unity that we do have. And I thank you that as the body of Christ walks through this day and the days ahead, that we can be doing so, rejoicing in a God who is given us your power, as you said in the end of Matthew, to the end of this age. And we trust you and we love you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Vicky, would you lead us into prayer, please?
Father, we love you. We come to you because Jesus has made the way possible. And so we come with boldness. And you have heard everything we've shared, the dreams, the visions, the passion for this nation. And Lord, the prophecies that you have spoken. And Lord, we ask that we would do our side of what you've spoken and promised for this nation. Because Lord, it's not just about our nation, as Noah said, it's about the nations. But Lord, in remembering the things that you've spoken, and Smith Wigglesworth with his last great awakening saying it would start here. Lord, we pray, give us the tools and the insight and the wisdom that we need to move with you, to keep step with you, and to run into those things that you're about to release in New Zealand. Because, Lord, another part of the word you spoke to me earlier this year is revival is now. And, Lord, that's what Terry was speaking about. So we pray, show us what our part is, that we would rise up, that we would wake up and walk into those things. And, Lord, in it, we say afresh, we trust you. Jesus, we know that you have given us the authority in your name to go and make disciples. May we be faithful to what you've called us to do. And we thank you, Holy Spirit, that you are our teacher, our guide, our comforter, and the power, the dunamis of God that flows through us. So we say, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, we need you. We can't do this without you. Empower us, Lord, that we wouldn't just be ones who speak of your word, but we would actually do it to your honor, for your glory, for the sake of New Zealand, but even greater, for your kingdom's sake in this world, we pray. As it is in heaven, so be it on in your precious name, Yeshua. Amen.
Amen. Okay, it's your turn. Noah, please lead us into prayer.
Father, we come before you with such thanksgiving in our heart, and we thank you for this nation, Father, and we thank you for the people of the land. We thank you, Almighty God, that you release the wind of your Holy Spirit, Father, from the top of the North Island to the bottom of the South Island, Father God, the West Coast, the East Coast, and everywhere in between. Father, we thank you that your word says decree a thing and it shall be established for you. And Father, I thank you that as your word has gone forth, Father, as we have been decreeing your word, Father, it shall be so. It shall be established in the hearts of the people. Father God, that you give the people ears to hear and eyes to see. Father, I thank you that you grip us with an awareness, Father God, that this nation, Father God, will be vibrant and alive. Father God, that where there have been many issues, Father God, where there has been, Father God, chaos, I thank you, Almighty God, that you, Father God, will descend with a spirit of peace, Father God, that revival, Father, will sweep upon this land. Father God, as we cry out in one accord, and Father, I thank you, Almighty God, that you are touching the young and you are touching the old, Father God, and you're touching, Father God, the Gen Zs, Father God, that you're placing such a hunger and a stirring in their hearts, and that they don't want, Father Father, as Larry Sparks would say, they don't want no baby Holy Ghost. And so, Father, we thank you that you are moving, that you are awakening, Father God, that you are breathing, Father God, upon Aotearoa, the land of the long white cloud. And so, Father, we thank you. Let it rain, Father God, let it rain upon the dry places, Father God, let it rain, Father God, let us get in the river, Father God, let us jump in, Father God, let us be all in, Father God, let us be so hungry, Father God, let us cry out, Father God, that you would incline your ear, Father God, and hear, Father God, the hearts of the people, Father God, as it is said in your word, Father God, that your word does not return unto you void, but God, that you will accomplish your word, Father, that your word will be sent and it will be made manifest, Father God, in our hearts, in our homes, in our schools, Father, in the ministry, in the church, in the workplace. So, Father, we thank you that you will affect, Father God, this nation, Father God, every mountain of influence, Father God, will be touched by the hand of God in Jesus' mighty name.
Amen. Amen. Najir Paul, would you lead us into prayer, please?
This is the moment where wind meets fire. Come on in. Come on, Lord. Our hearts are burning for fresh revival. Blow again. Our God is a consuming fire. Our God is a holy one. Whatever you speak is done. Yes. Whatever you touch will live. Father, we pray today, Lord God. Father, as that song says, where wind meets fire, Lord, the nation of New Zealand, Lord, is ready for your refiner revival fire that is already blowing across the whenua. And Lord, today we say, come on in, come on in, come on in. As the sisters have said and the brothers have said, come on into our governmental system. Come on into our manai. Come on into our homes. Come on into our educational systems and into our schools. Come on in, Father, into the lands and speak into every part, Lord God, into every nook and every cranny, Lord, into every awa, every river, Lord, into every maunga and every mountain. In the mighty name of Jesus, come into every marae. Father, we release the fire of God over the city and away and over the city and the cities of New Zealand, like it's never been released before. And Father, I call forth for every warrior to rise up. As you reminded me, I want to just take a moment now to just mihi atu to the sister here, Ngā Wā Kupa. It is not a mistake. People watching, it is not a mistake. God does things very symbolic. This woman here, her name is Ngā Wā. Ngā Wā's name means time. Time. Ko te nei te wā. Now is the time. Ngā Wā's surname is Kupa. Now Kupa means, let me just get this right, Kupa also means it's something to do with a person who makes and repairs barrels. Large wooden containers used for, get this, holding wine. Holding wine. So this woman sitting on this panel today represents several things. And Father, I just thank you, Lord, as you showed me that, as you showed me that that she is symbolic, her whole name, that, Lord, you are pouring out a new wine. The brother Adnan said it earlier. You're pouring out a new wine upon the nation of Aotearoa, and Ngā Wā is representing to all of us today that, Lord, you were saying, ko tēnei te wā, now is the time. So, Father, we release in the name of Jesus your people to go forth in due season, not later, but now. Right now, it is time for us as a nation, every creed, every tongue, every tribe to come together and to forcefully advance the kingdom of God, not just here in Aotearoa, but in all nations, in Jesus' mighty name. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Lord, we thank you. We lift up the nation of New Zealand to you with our faithful heart, Lord. And Lord, as you know that I love the nation of New Zealand and its people, Lord. And Lord, you are bringing unity in Maori and also Pākehā people, Lord. And Lord, I believe that revival is going to come as we reconcile with the First Nation, Lord. And Lord, we ask that you bring that covenant relationship that brings a great fruit in this land. And Lord, we decree and declare from one corner, North and South Island, both island, Lord, we ask the fire ignite across nation. And Lord, in the name of Jesus, that unstoppable fire, unstoppable mobilization of a great awakening throughout the nation of New Zealand. Lord, we pray that as the Maori queen is like a young, it's ascended to the throne. But Lord, we pray right now that younger generations come forward as a remnant, taking their place and going all across the nation of New Zealand and spread out. And Lord, we pray those who are afar, prodigal sons and daughters, to come back and Lord, take their place in Jesus Christ, who they are, their identity found in Christ. We pray for revival, a fire all across the nation of New Zealand. Lord, we pray for spiritual awakening. The hearts begins to turn back to Christ. And Lord, New Zealand is a part of a billion soul harvest. That's 5.5 million people. Lord, we pray that experience, even the immigrants, all those people are there, Lord. Those who don't know you, don't have a personal, intimate relationship, not just to call themselves a Christian, but call themselves a Christ follower. That's what exactly we want. Lord, it's not about the religious. It's not about what numbers the Christianity is in New Zealand. But Lord, we really want the hearts to be turning towards you. We ask miracles, signs, and wonders. And Lord, we ask a great awakening in this land. In the mighty name of our Lord Jesus Christ, New Zealand belongs to Jesus. New Zealand is for Jesus. We thank you, Jesus, for showing compassion and favor, Lord, to this great nation. We pray, Lord, for the protection of New Zealand. And Lord, all the attacks of enemy be canceled against this nation. And let the plan of God fulfill in this nation. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray. Amen. Amen. Well, thank you so much, guys. I know my...
Are you there?
Turned off. That's how you know that it's time to, you know, end this broadcast. I'm going to use over my second camera. There you go. So I'm back on. So thank you so much. I can't take this moment lightly. I honor all of you and thank you so much for giving your time. I believe it was a very necessary and important. That's why I felt like urgency in my heart. What Sister Najera shared, even she sang a national anthem. It was not planned. It was not like scripted. It just naturally flowed. I want to thank you and all of you for coming on this broadcast. And I want to encourage our audience to please share this. We want to get at least a million people to watch this broadcast, at least a million people. And it's going to happen in the name of Jesus.
Yeah.
We thank you for this in advance. Amen. Well, thank you so much. Have a blessed day. We will connect soon.
Before you all go, I want to thank you guys for being, I believe this is probably the most powerful broadcast that we've done concerning the Church of New Zealand. And I think one thing needs to come out of this. We need to get